Hello, I'm Andrew Main, and a question I often get is, how did I get my job at OpenAI? For some background, I was at OpenAI for 4 years, starting in 2020. I was the original prompt engineer there. I think I was probably the first person to ever be a full-time prompt engineer. I wore a lot of different hats there, but the reason they hired me was because of my skills in prompting AI models. Now, prior to that, I had never had a technology job. About 9 years ago, I decided that I wanted to pivot from TV and everything I was doing there into tech. And this is in my 40s. And for somebody at that point in their life, that might be kind of a scary transition. I was just motivated by curiosity. I just felt like things were just way more interesting technology. They moved fast. And as somebody who loved to just learn new things and build things, it seemed like where I really should have been. So to get into it, I just started doing online courses. I'd go to Udemy, and every time they had a $15 course or something that I wanted to learn, I would take it. And I probably did this the wrong way. And what I would do is I'd have an idea for something I wanted to build, and then I would go find a course that matched that. For example, I wanted to build a website to make it easy for authors to list their books and update it. As a person who writes 2 books a year, this seemed like something pretty useful. So I followed a course on Ruby on Rails to learn how to build the website to do that. Then I had ideas for iOS applications. So I would take a course on programming in Swift. And continuously doing this with the idea that I was going to create a company, which didn't happen. And so this is a common pattern for creative people where we get very excited about something. We put a lot of energy into it, and then we stop. Now, what I had done, though, was trained myself to finish it to at least it was at the point I could press a button and launch the company, rather than giving up somewhere along the path when it got technical or got very hard. And, you know, I have people think that these things come easy to me, and I wish it was true. I'm not a prodigy. I'm the kind of person that literally has to spend sometimes longer than other people learning a thing to understand it. But my one strength is I'm extremely stubborn. I will not give up if I decide that I want to do a thing. Once I do it, I might just walk away. But at least for my own sanity, I have to sort of prove that I could do it. This really became true when I did my Shark Week special for Discovery Channel, where basically, I told them I would be happy to go swim with great white sharks and prove that I, as a magician and a technologist, could figure out how they saw things and make myself invisible through tech, which is a crazy, stupid thing to say or put yourself in a position to do, but I did. And I remember as I was on a boat going out to some remote island called the Isle of Jaws, where great whites would circle around and feed on seals, I remember thinking to myself, man, my mouth really takes me places maybe I shouldn't go. But also I knew that I was stubborn. I was going to figure out how to do it and make it work. And I did. And I would say that was probably one of the best patterns I was able to break myself out of, was just starting a thing and giving up when it got hard. I learned to double down when it got hard and finish it and then take it to the final step where I would then just have to say, okay, now I'm talking about a commitment for doing this for a long period of time. And in building all kinds of applications and registering domains and whatnot for things I thought were going to be the great things I was going to build, I certainly learned a lot of things about how to make things and how to not make things. I also spent a lot of time just following where the technology was headed, and in particular, looking at artificial intelligence. I was into AI when I was a kid. I used to build little basic programs, very simple ones that would just be conversational. And I was into robotics. I would take things apart. I would build mechanical arms using bicycle brakes as grippers. I loved just making things. And that ended up getting channeled into magic. And I became a magic creator. So I worked with other magicians. I worked with David Blaine and Penn and Teller and helped create illusions. That process, by the way, is kind of what helped me get my job at OpenAI, which I'll touch upon in a second. So following what was going on in AI, in 2019, OpenAI announced GPT-2. Now, GPT-2 was the next version of GPT. GPT was an idea they had after taking a look at a paper that Google had published called Attention is All You Need, about a different kind of algorithm for basically learning, a way to have an algorithm pay attention to things and then figure out how to adjust and improve its learning rate. And so OpenAI took this and basically scaled it up. And with GPT-2, they basically were able to generate entire paragraphs and write articles. So they took a bunch of outputs from GPT-2 and they published them online on a site called GitHub. And I went there and I read every single output from GPT-2. I was fascinated. Now, there was a paper that went along with it, and I could understand some of it, but really I have to learn by looking at things and trying to understand what goes on behind the scenes. Now, for a brief bit of background, along with being somebody involved in magic, I was also involved with promoting and teaching critical thinking. I'm very fascinated by the way that we process information. We hear terms like misinformation a lot, but not a lot of conversation about how we process things. And I think that misinformation can be a bit of a canard because two people can have the same piece of information and come to very different conclusions, and it comes down to the way we think. How we think is a very, very important thing for us to try to understand. And I could go at length about this, but the short form is one of the things that I think is a very powerful tool is a concept called theory of mind, which is basically the idea that I have or you have of what goes on in somebody else's head. All we have is external information, and people who have very good theory of mind generally aren't surprised by the actions of others. People who have very weak theory of mind go, I can't believe this person did this the eighth time in a row. So how does this apply to GPT-2? Well, these are algorithms that are designed to learn, generate text, and process information. And I don't know that there's really a mind there, but there is a system that processes information much like our own brains do. So in reading all the outputs from GPT-2, I started to get an understanding of how it was able to pay attention to certain things, how it had trouble with bigger concepts and stuff and would fall off, and then how it would pay attention to what it had just outputted, and then when it would sort of degrade. And I could see a pattern there, and it was very, very interesting to me, and I talked about it. During that time, I was hosting a podcast with my friends Brian Brushwood and Justin Robert Young, and we would talk about what was going on in AI. I remember reading excerpts from GPT-2 on the podcast, excited about this because it was, one, kind of funny because it talked about unicorns and stuff, but also we could see there was something really cool happening. Well, it turned out that somebody at OpenAI listened to the podcast, and I got an email from OpenAI asking if I would sign an NDA because they wanted to show me something. And of course, I said yes. So I hopped on a call and I met a woman named Ashley Pilipazin, who ended up becoming my manager at OpenAI, and she showed me GPT-3. Now, what she didn't know was I was GPT-2's biggest fanboy. It was just somebody at OpenAI, David Lansky, had said, hey, this guy might be interested in this. Let's show it to him and see if he wants to talk about it or do something cool with it. And luck really did play a part in it, but that happened because I was talking about it. And that's something I'll get into in a moment about what you need to do, I think, to find yourself in really cool opportunities. So I got a demo of what GPT-3 could do at that point, and I was just excited. I could see that all of a sudden, this was a huge leap from GPT-2. And then I was given access to GPT-3 and told go play with it. And I did. I did a lot. I stayed up 24 hours straight trying all these different things, trying things I tried with GPT-2, by the way, trying things that didn't work before that now suddenly worked. And I could see that something was happening here. This was where I needed to be spending all of my time now. So I started telling OpenAI, you know, if you did this, it can do this. You can try this. I was building many applications. I was plugging into all these kinds of places. I was using the same kind of magic brain that I'd used for creating magic tricks and applying it to GPT-3. As a magician, you take an object like a Rubik's Cube or a deck of cards, and you try to think of what you can do with it that people wouldn't expect. What is some property about this that other people may not be aware of? So you explore. I took that creative drive, that, you know, puzzle making curiosity, sort of whatever you want to call it, and applied it to this new technology. And I kept sending them videos, and they started asking me questions. They said, hey, people are having trouble trying to figure out how you might get it to parse this paragraph. Do you think you could do it? And I was not going to say no. I was not going to let it down. I would literally spend hours and hours and hours trying to solve the most trivial problem to figure out if I could get a solution. And in doing that, you know, I learned a lot about how it worked. One of the ways you learn about something is not when it does a thing right, but when it does something wrong. In psychology, there's the classic story of Phineas Gage. He was a railroad worker and a spike went through his brain, and basically his behavior was different after the fact. He functioned differently, and people tried to understand why was this, what was impacted in his brain that made him behave differently before and after. And I thought about this a lot with GPT-3, because every time I'd ask it for something, it would give me a wrong answer. I'd be like, okay, Why did it do this instead of the thing that I thought it should? And this was how I became a prompt engineer, was I understood or tried to have a process for understanding why the model did what it did. And I started to be pretty good at figuring out how to get it to do what you wanted to. And I started writing in these examples. And OpenAI said, would you like to write some documentation for this? I said, sure. So I started writing what then became the GPT-3 documentation with a bunch of prompt examples and showing people how to make use of this capability. Now, at the time, I thought I was going to go create a company on top of GPT-3. I had an idea and built out an app called AI Channels, and this was a chatbot, very much like ChatGPT is today. And again, this was an obvious thing. There were chatbots before, et cetera, but I had the advantage of being able to plug GPT-3 into it, and I built in web search and function calling, and I would create these very long prompts to get these tasks to work. And that was taking advantage of just all the things I was finding out about how to engineer prompts. I was also trying to figure out how to solve problems, like if I want to have a really long conversation, but I only have 2,000 tokens or maybe 1,500 words, what happens when I reach that limit? So I would figure out methods for summarizing what came before, insert it into the thread. I would use retrieval methods. We had semantic search, which is a way to look for these embeddings matches, sort of these fuzzy matches. And by the way, understand that this was April of 2020, and we didn't even have the term RAG until November. So for people working at the frontier of GPT-3, trying to make use of it, you were trying a lot of different things. I was writing chain of thought prompts. I was doing this because as somebody who had taught people how to do magic tricks, I would have to teach people step by step by step. And you could see all these places and directions this technology could go. It was a very, very exciting time. So I thought I was going to go launch AI Channels. In fact, in June of 2020, when OpenAI formally announced GPT-3 as an API, my app was showcased. You could actually still go look there today and see AI Channels and see this very chatbot interface sort of tool that let you write, search the web, etc. But there was a problem. And that was GPT-3 in 2020, I thought was good enough for a lot of things, but it was slow, expensive, and the context length was very, very short. So 2,000 tokens, like I said, is about 1,500 words. And if I'm doing 300 or 400 word prompts, meant that you had to wait a while for it to respond. And I was asked by Greg Brockman if I was going to launch this as a company, and I said no. And I think that some of the people were a little bit disappointed because it seemed like a really cool place where this technology could go. But I knew at that point it was going to take time for the models to get better and to the point where I could really make this work the way I wanted to. I could have launched as an app and charged like $30 a month or something like that to do it, but it just wasn't what I wanted to do. I wanted to build something that continuously got better and not just take advantage of the fact that I had access to GPT-3 before other people. So I decided not to go try to build that into a company, which maybe it was a dumb mistake. It probably could have been something that would have been funded, could have been big. But I also understood that eventually things like this would be a commodity and you needed to be a much bigger company building something like this and have foundational models, et cetera. The real opportunities were going to come later on when you figured out what else you could do with that. So I told OpenAI, I said, hey, listen, if you want the world's oldest intern, let me know. I'd love to work with you. And they said, we'd love to have you. And so I started OpenAI as what's called a core contractor. So basically I was a contractor, but I had full access and got to do a lot of really cool things and got to understand the whole plan that they were approaching and did that for several months and then was asked to become a full-time employee. Why did they ask me to become an engineer at OpenAI when I had no prior engineering experience at another company? And the answer is I built things. I made things. Instead of a resume that showed them what I could do, I built things in front of them that they could see and where things were obviously useful. And that's my advice to everybody, even if you have a good resume, is be building things. Be a person out there creating in public. Other people who've come to OpenAI since then or even before were people who were either publishing papers or doing really useful work. And that's my advice. If you want to go work for a company like OpenAI, is make things. And it doesn't have to be some big things. It's going to be a bunch of little things. The more things you make, the more things you understand. The other thing I suggest is be useful. So I was writing documentation for GPT-3. I was also creating tools for other people on how to use GPT-3. I created a site called GPT Tools. And for a period of time, OpenAI was linking to my personal website because of the tools I'd created because things were moving very fast. Sam Altman, Greg Brockman gave me the mandate, go build things, just keep moving quickly because we have to figure out how to make use of this technology. So building things, being useful, learning things, taking every course I could, diving into things, and also being at the frontier. Trying to figure out how to talk to these language models was a new thing, and I was excited to try doing this because that meant there really weren't any experts. Now there are a lot of really gifted people working on prompt engineering, but it takes one or two people at the start to say, hey, there's something interesting here. And there are many more frontiers now than there were before. Often people go like, yeah, but you know, that was the time to go back then and be a prompt engineer. There are so many other areas right now that not enough people are trying to explore. Fine-tuning is an example. If you read the documentation for how to fine-tune a model, it's generally going to tell you how to create something between generalization and memorization, but not a lot of information about how to go on either side, how to structure what you're trying to do, et cetera. And we have all different kinds of ways of fine-tuning now. We actually can do preference fine-tuning. We can train reasoning models. There are all these new frontiers that I don't see enough people getting into, to be honest with you, and it's very easy to become an expert. Now, my company, Interdimensional, we work with all kinds of AI experts that have very unconventional career paths because they're very knowledgeable about certain things. And when a company comes to us and says, we need help trying to figure this thing out, I love finding people that are builders and creators that are out there doing that. Be out there building, be creative, be useful, be a team player. I used to sit on the hiring panels at OpenAI for certain roles. And one of the things we looked for is this person going to fit well into a team? And when you apply for a company, this is a thing you have to realize. Kind of the secret is there's HR, which says, okay, this person might be a good candidate for this company. Then there's the team. And sometimes you get really capable people that are great, maybe at another team, but not for the team that's hiring at that point. So if you ever try to apply and you don't get hired, don't feel hurt, because what happens often is that you might have two candidates and one is slightly better in one little area or something they need, or it's just a different need for that team, but you might be perfect somewhere else at a different part of a company. So you got to just keep doing it and finding the places where you're useful. I wore a lot of different hats at OpenAI. Although I started off doing prompt engineering, I found myself quickly working on things like documentation. I helped work on the pitch deck that was sent to Microsoft for the multi-billion dollar deal. That was kind of a crazy thing to see this amazing plan put in place for what was going to happen for the next several years. I would work on things like putting together videos to show people how to use this stuff. I eventually became the science communicator at OpenAI, which I did for 2 years, where I would go visit the White House. I would talk to reporters. So I got to wear a bunch of different hats and do a bunch of different things there. After I left and created my own company, I got asked by OpenAI to host their official podcast, which launched a couple weeks ago. And I do a lot of fun things with the OpenAI alumni community, helping younger students, working on projects, helping other companies get off the ground, et cetera. So it's been a wonderful journey and a wonderful experience. But my big takeaways are this. One is, know how to be a team player, make things. If you want to learn, make things, but also always be learning about things. If you came in front of me and you were interviewing for a job, my first question to you is, what have you made? Now you might say, hey, I'm not technical. I'm applying for a job on the comms team. It'd be like, well, what have you done there? And I talked to people who built nonprofits. I talked to people who'd done a lot of community activity, people that organized groups at their colleges. That's what I want to see, is somebody who has made things. And it can either be physically making a thing, it could be making a thing out of code, it could be writing books, or it can be organizing people, putting a group of people together in a room with a common purpose, whether it's to talk about movies or talk about reinforcement learning, is making a thing. So that's my biggest piece of advice. Make things.